الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. من كتاب وسائل الوصول إلى شمائل الرسول لسيدنا يوسف النبهاني رحمه الله رضي الله عنا وعنكم، إلى أن قال: التنبيه الأول في معنى لفظ الشمائل، وهي في الأصل الأخلاق والطبائع. وقال في القاموس: الشمال الطبع والجمع شمائل. وقال في لسان العرب: مفردها شمال بكسر الشين. وقال جرير: وما لومي أخي من شماليا. وقال صخر أخو الخنساء: أبا الشتم إني قد أصاب كريمتي، وأن ليس إهداء الخناء من شماليا. وقال آخر: هم قومي قد أنكرت منهم، شمائل بدلوها من شمالي، أي أنكرت أخلاقهم. ثم قال في مادتها أيضا: والشمال خليقة الرجل، جمعها شمائل، وإنها حسنة الشمائل. ورجل كريم الشمائل، أي في أخلاقه مخالطته. وقد استعمل علماء الحديث شمائل في أخلاقه الشريفة صلى الله عليه وسلم على أصلها، وفي أوصاف صورته الظاهرة أيضا على سبيل المجازي، فاعلم ذلك.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. And in this Mubarak text, وسائل الوصول إلى شمائل الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم, that by the great Shaykh, the Alim, the Qadi, Allam, al-Muhaddith, Yusuf bin Ismail, النبهاني رحمه الله تعالى, he combines from multiple sources, as he mentions previously in his introduction, which we didn't touch on for the sake of time, but he says previously that he compiled all of the abwab, all of the chapters in Ash-Shamail al-Muhammadiyya of Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah. However, he didn't order this particular text in accordance with the order of the chapters of Imam al-Tirmidhi's text, as well as taking from several other texts of Shama'il, which he mentions previously in his introduction. And then in this opening chapter, this Imam, Imam who lived by the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and had visions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and was an abundant musalli ala Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and someone who khadam al-janab al-nabawi, who served the prophetic personality and the prophetic descriptions in all of its meanings. And if you look at so many of the books of Imam al-Nabahani, so many of them are connected to the personality and to the salawat upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in this beginning, this opening chapter, he mentions the definition of ash-shimal, the plural being ash-shama'il, and he says that the shimal is the characteristic or the quality, characteristic or quality of the human being, and its plural, its jama' is shama'il. And the scholars of hadith utilized the term shama'il to refer to the inward characteristics as well as the outward features and descriptions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in the next chapter, he is going to mention for us the fawa'id, the benefits that a mu'min will attain through glancing their eyes and observing their heart over the shama'il, the internal and external qualities of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
التنبيه الثاني في فوائد المقصودة من جمع شمائل صلى الله عليه وسلم. ليس المقصود من جمع شمائله صلى الله عليه وسلم مجرد معرفة علم تاريخي تميل إليه النفوس، وتجنح إليه القلوب ويتحدث به في المجالس ويستشهد به على المقاصد ونحو ذلك من فوائد. وإنما المقصود من جمع شمائله صلى الله عليه وسلم فوائد أخرى مهمة في الدين.
So he mentions, what are these benefits that we seek in compiling and gathering the Shama'il of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam? He says, this is not simply a historical knowledge that we're seeking. يعني علم تاريخي. We're not studying history here. This is something more than that. This is not simply a matter that we're going to use as knowledge, which we're going to exchange amongst ourselves in the gatherings that people have. But rather, he says, there are other benefits. There are other noble objectives, and now he's going to mention them.
منها التلذذ بصفاته العلية وشمائله الردية صلى الله عليه وسلم، ومنها التقرب إليه صلى الله عليه وسلم واستجلاب محبته ورضاه بذكر أوصافه الكاملة وأخلاقه الفاضلة، كما يتقرب الشاعر إلى كريم بذكر أوصافه الجميلة وخصاله النبيلة.
So the first two benefits behind the gathering and the immersing ourselves in the Shama'il of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is to attain delight and take enjoyment in his noble attributes and his descriptions, to draw close to him sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and to earn his love and his pleasure by the simple mentioning of those perfect qualities and those character traits. And he mentions the example, just like a poet would draw near to a person by mentioning their beautiful qualities and features, in a similar way we do for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam.
ولا شك أن جمع شمائله صلى الله عليه وسلم ونشرها هو أفضل وأكمل من مدحه للقصائد. وقد رضي عمن مدحه بها كحسان وعبد الله بن رواحة وكعب بن زهير رضي الله تعالى عنهم وكافأهم على ذلك. فلا شك أنه يرضى عمن يعتني بجمع شمائله ونشرها صلى الله عليه وسلم.
And he صلى الله عليه وسلم amongst the Sahaba that would praise him through their poetry, such as Sayyidina Hassan ibn Thabit, Abdullah ibn Rawaha, Ka'ab ibn Zuhair, their compilation of these poems. He mentions, Imam al-Alhani rahimahullah, that the coming together or the bringing together of his descriptions of his shama'il in texts such as these are far superior than simply praising him through qasa'id, through odes. And in this text, we find a complete and comprehensive description of him from all angles of his life, outwardly and inwardly, in order for the believer to then take as an example.
ومنها تعرضنا لمكافأته صلى الله عليه وسلم على إحسانه إلينا وإنقاذه إيانا من ظلمات الضلال إلى أنوار الهدى، ومن الشقاوة الأبدية إلى السعادة السرمدية. وهذه نعمة كبرى لا تمكن مقابلتها بشيء، ولا يقدر على مكافأته عليها إلا الله تعالى. فجزاه الله تعالى عنا أفضل ما جزى به مرسلا عمن أرسل إليه، فإنه أنقذنا به من الهلاكة وجعلنا من خير أمة أخرجت للناس، دائنين بدينه الذي ارتضى واصطفاه به ملائكته ومن أنعم عليه من خلقه. فلم تمسي بنا نعمة ظهرت ولا بطنت نلنا بها حظا في دين ودنيا أو رفع بها عنا مكروه فيهما أو في أحد منهما إلا ومحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم سببها، القائد إلى آخرها والهادي إلى رشدها.
نعم. And then the next benefit here of compiling all of these shama'il, these descriptions and qualities of Al-Habib Al-A'zam Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that when we do so, we now are in a position to give in return for his excellence towards us. If any human being does any good or favor or offer of benefit to you, then the default is to respond to that, to respond to the good with the good and to pay them back. So he gives the example of how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taken us from the dhulumat, from the darknesses, of course, from the darknesses of misguidance and the darknesses of disbelief and error, to the lights of Islam, to the lights of Hidayah. And having saved us from an eternal punishment to eternal felicity, and that is sa'ada and happiness in Jannah. So this is a huge bounty, it's a huge gift through Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because we would not have known Allah were it not for Muhammadun Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when the ulama talk about the greatest blessing, the greatest ni'mah upon the mu'min, even before Islam, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because were it not for him, we would not have known La ilaha illallah, we would not have known Kaaba, we would not have known Hajj, not have known Salah, no Siyah, no Zakah, except through him. He says, "Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli, khudu anni manasikakum." Pray as you see me pray. So how can a mu'min perfect their prayer unless they see before them Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? How can they perform their Hajj and their rites of their Umrah unless they take it directly from him, or those who have taken it, or those who have taken it from people who have taken it from Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or through the Asanid and the Salasil? So this is a grace, this is a gift, he says. We cannot pay back as mu'mineen. How do we pay back Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for this great gift? None can give to him in full measure except Allah. Only Allah Ta'ala can reward him. And so he says, may Allah reward him on our behalf with the best that one has ever given his messenger. For Allah has saved us from destruction and made us the best nation. Our khayriya as an ummah, kuntum khayra ummatin. You are the best of nations. Ukhrijat linnas, that has been delivered unto mankind. Ta'muruna bil ma'rufi wa tanhawna 'anil munkari wa tu'minuna billah. You're commanding good and you're forbidding evil and your belief in Allah. These three are from Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We would not have known how to do amr al ma'ruf, command good. We would not have known how to forbid evil, and we would not have known how to believe in Allah were not for Muhammad and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we take the shahadatain, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, awwaluha nafi, begins with negation. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, that negation followed by affirmation. Wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, and they were bearing witness and testifying that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. No one knows Allah like Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And no follower of Muhammad and Rasulullah will ever come to know Allah unless they come through the bab of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's the door and he's the gateway. He was the gateway for the Anbiya. He was the gateway for Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam. Because Sayyidina Adam asked Allah by the right of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to forgive his erring in Jannah when he ate by the tree, ate from the tree. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted his tawbah, and he asked him, how did you know Muhammad and I haven't yet created him? And so Sayyidina Adam says, wherever I looked in Jannah, I saw in the Qawam of the Arsh, and I saw in the doorways of Jannah written, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I came to know that you would never attach any name to your name unless it was the most beloved of names to you. And so Allah Ta'ala says, O Adam, you've spoken the truth, and were it not for him, I would not have created you. Allah. And so therefore, the objective of the creation of all of the dunya is for Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to manifest. As Allah Ta'ala says, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ, and we raise your mention.
وَهَذِهِ الْعِبَارَةُ مِنْ قَوْلِهِ فَجَزَاهُ اللَّهُ إِلَىٰ آخِرِهَا عبارة الإمام الشافعي رضي الله تعالى عنه نقلتها من رسالته التي رواها عنه صاحبه الربيع بن سليمان رحمه الله تعالى. ومنها أن معرفة شمائله الشريفة تستدعي محبته صلى الله عليه وسلم، لأن الإنسان مجبول على حب الصفات الجميلة ومن اتصف بها، ولا أجمل ولا أكمل من صفاته صلى الله عليه وسلم. فلا شك أن من يطلع عليها ولم يكن مطبوعا على قلبه بطابع الضلال يحب صاحبها صلى الله عليه وسلم بيقين، وبمقدار زيادة محبته ونقصها تكون زيادة الإيمان ونقصه. بل رضا الله تعالى والسعادة الأبدية ونعيم أهل الجنة ودرجاتهم فيها جميع ذلك يكون بمقدار محبة العبد له صلى الله عليه وسلم زيادة ونقصان، كما أن سخط الله تعالى والشقاوة الأبدية والعذاب أهل النار ودركاتهم فيها يكون بمقدار بغضه صلى الله عليه وسلم زيادة ونقصا.
نعم. This next benefit here of compiling the Shama'il of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم is that it results in محبته, earning love for him عليه الصلاة والسلام, meaning the love of the mu'min for Nabi Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام. And this love for him, he says, because a human being is predisposed to love beautiful qualities. Naturally, generally, if we see a quality that's beautiful, that's nice in someone, we tend to love that particular quality and we love the person who possesses that quality. He says, there are no qualities more beautiful and more perfect than those of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So therefore, there's no doubt that whoever examines these qualities, these shama'il, this is the benefit of observing and gazing upon the shama'il and learning them and reading them. So long as his heart is not sealed with a seal of misguidance. Meaning as long as Allah Ta'ala has decreed before the creation of the heavens and the earth that so-and-so, the such-and-such person is from the su'ada, from the felicitous, that they will eventually enter Jannah, then he says, so long as it's not sealed with the seal of misguidance, he will love the one who possesses them with yaqeen, with certitude, and that is Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So discussion of these shama'il produces mahabba for Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And of course the sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they didn't need to read the shama'il because they had sahib al-shama'il before them. And so all they would need to do is open their eyes, open their ears, not even open their eyes or open their ears. For the likes of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Maktum radiallahu ta'ala anhu couldn't see with his eyes. He was blind. He didn't need to open his eyes because he had basira. He had the insight. And he had the suhbah of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So to define the sahaba of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's not necessary that they would physically see him, but just for them to be in his hadra, just for them to be in his presence, for them to be in his suhbah, in his company, in his gathering, they become sahaba. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gazes upon all of them. The nadhar of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is upon all of the sahaba. And that's why the sahaba, the lowest of the ranks of the sahaba, if you were to get all of the awliya and the salihin after them in the ummah, their iman and their position with Allah wouldn't equate to the lowest of the ranks of sahaba. Why? Because they were sahaba to Nabi. They looked upon him and they gazed upon him and they ate with him and they walked with him and they traveled with him and they lived with him. Khayrul qurun qarni. He says the best of time, best of generations is my generation, and then the one after that, and then the one after that. And so we have the zaman of sahaba, and then we have the zaman of the tabi'een, and we have zaman of tabi'i tabi'een, wa hakada, until our day. So this produces mahabba, love. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the A'rabi and the Bedouin comes to him and he asks him, mata sa'a, he says to him, mata dha a'dadta laha, when's the last hour? He says, what have you prepared for it? He says, I haven't prepared much fasting nor prayer, but I love Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, al-mar'u ma'a man ahab, aw al-mar'u yuhsharu ma'a man ahab. A person will be resurrected with the one whom they love. And Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik says, when I heard this, he says, this was the best news that I ever received, and I love Allah, and I love His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I love Abu Bakr, and I love Umar, and Uthman, and Ali. And he begins, mashallah, to indulge in the love, and he hopes to be with them. He always hopes to be with them on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And so the Sahaba, they place their reliance on their love and mahabba of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the increase and decrease, he says, the increase and decrease in iman is connected to increase and decrease of a person's mahabba for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You want increase in iman, increase your mahabba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You want decrease of iman, you'll see that's a result of decrease of love of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says you want the rida of Allah, the good pleasure of Allah. You want Jannah. You want the degrees in Jannah. He says all this is in direct proportion to the abd loving Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we're an ummah that its central focal point is the mahabba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Naam.
ومنها اتباعه والاقتداء به لمن وفقه الله تعالى فيما يمكن به الاقتداء كسخائه وحلمه وتواضعه وزهده وعبادته وغيرها من مكارم الأخلاق وشرائف أحواله صلى الله عليه وسلم وذلك مستوجب لمحبة الله تعالى التي فيها سعادة الدارين. وقال تعالى قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله. جعلنا الله تعالى من المتبعين له صلى الله عليه وسلم بشريعه القويم وصراطه المستقيم وحشرنا تحت لوائه في زمرة أهل محبته عليه وعليهم الصلاة والتسليم.
آمين. And the final benefit Imam Nabhani mentions is that for those whom Allah Ta'ala grants tawfiq and success is the following and the emulating of his examples in the areas in which we can follow him. Iqtida. Iqtida of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is one of the greatest ways to take this ummah from its regression and from its darkness and from its following the ways of those whom Allah Ta'ala is displeased with. Because he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala created him and sent him to this ummah, he didn't love, nor did he honor, nor did he raise or elevate any creation like he did of Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wa sallam. So therefore his karam, his generosity, his jood, his forbearance, his hilm, his mercy, his rahmah, his tawadu', our sayyid al-mutawadi'in, his humility, his humbleness. مَنْ تَوَاضَعَ لِلَّهِ رَفَعَهُ اللَّهِ, he says, the person who humbles themselves. For Allah's sake, Allah will raise them, Allah will raise their status. So these are characteristics that we find in the Shama'il. What are they there for? They're there for istida. They're there to, in order to follow, in order to apply in our lives. His zuhud. Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha would say, the three moons would pass, meaning 3 months would pass. And there would be no fire lit in the house of Muhammad. So she'd be asked, and what was your food? What did you eat? Al-Aswad, dates and water. For 3 months. How many of us have that sabr? How many of us have that patience? How many of us have that zuhud, that detachment? And this is there in order for us to apply. His worship, his ibadah. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. What's the primary objective of our existence? Ibadah. Who worshipped Allah better than anyone? Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So how was his qiyam, and how was his salah, and how was his siyam, and how was his sadaqah, and how was his khuluq hasan, and how was his good characteristics? All of this is there in order for us to take example from. And all of his other akhlaq. He says, أَقْرَبُكُمْ إِلَيَّ مَجْلِسًا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَحَاسِنُكُمْ أَخْلَاقًا. The closest of you to me on the day of resurrection are those amongst you who have the best character. Ya Salah, Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا. And when you speak with people, speak beautifully, speak gently, speak kindly. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would speak kindly even with his enemies. And he would pardon those who would terrorize him and would attempt to assassinate him, because he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say, مَنْ لَا يَرْحَمْ لَا يُرْحَمْ. A person who doesn't show compassion to others, compassion will be shown to him. So in the Shama'il, we find the example of the greatest of human beings in order for us to apply, inshaAllah, in this month of Rabi' al-Awwal. That's our ahad, inshaAllah. That's our contract that we place between us and ourselves. And Allah Ta'ala and His Malaika are witness that these Shama'il that we come across, and that we read, that we reflect upon, we recite, not only is it with the intention to increase our knowledge of the high status of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but also to implement that which we can implement of his akhlaq in our lives, in our homes, with our families, with our friends, with our brothers, with our sisters. No. Iqra. Anyone who next? Iqra. No. Iqra. Bismillah.
رضي الله عنا وعنكم إلى أن قال الباب الأول في نسب رسول
في
الله
نسبي.
في نسب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
This is the next chapter, which is the nasab. The nasab meaning his lineage, صلى الله عليه وسلم, his ancestors, his grandfathers. Allah تبارك وتعالى mentions in the Quran, وتقلبك في الساجدين, and your movement from one sajid to the next, from one prostrator to the next. And the ulama take this as a dalil and a sign that every single father and grandfather and ancestor in the lineage of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was muwahhid sajid. How can you be sajid unless you're muwahhid? How can you be a prostrator unless you're prostrating to the one Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala? All the way back through to Sayyidina Ibrahim. And this also indicates that the father of Sayyidina Ibrahim was a muwahhid. And that the one that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, wa bihi azar. And his father Azar, meaning his uncle Azar. So the ulama say, why would Allah Ta'ala mention his name Azar? Abihi, Abihi, his father. But here to distinguish him from his natural father, because the Arabs used to also use the word father for the uncle. And the proof of this is when Sayyidina Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was 12 years old. And he went in a trade journey with his uncle Abu Talib. And they passed by camp of Bahira or Buhayra. And it's interesting that his name is Bahira, because they say in the area where that blessed tree, Shajara al-Mubarakah, is in Jordan, certain times of the year, they'll find a whole lake around that tree. A whole lake around that tree. So his name was Bahira or Buhayra, which means lake or small pool of water. And there's no other trees in this vicinity. No. So he asked when the group came and they received Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a child. He asked, are you all there? You're all there? They said yes. And then he finally found out that no, that child wasn't. So when he came in, he asked them, he said, who's his father? He said, this one's his father. And they pointed out Abu Talib. I'm his father. He says, impossible. His father can't be alive. So when he asked, who's his father? Where's his father? And they responded, this is his father. I mean, they understood that the word father here refers to the uncle, same maqam, same status. Now, so, in essence, all of the ancestors of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, through Sayyidina Ibrahim, all the way to Sayyidina Adam, were all believing in Allah. Now.
في نسبه الشريف صلى الله عليه وسلم وسيدنا محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
And this nasab here, inshallah, our first homework is to memorize this nasab al-sharif, to memorize this noble lineage. Because to memorize the noble lineage of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is an act that is pleasing to Allah and is pleasing to Him, because you're coming to know who was his father and who was his grandfather and great-grandfather and the rest of his ancestors, alayhi salatu wassalam. So if we can sit down for 5 minutes, 10 minutes every night and review it and practice it and memorize it in our family with our children. This is one beautiful thing that we can take, inshallah, from this first week of this blessed month.
وسيدنا محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ابن عبد الله ابن عبد المطلب ابن هاشم ابن عبد مناف ابن قصي ابن كلاب ابن مقرة ابن كعب ابن لؤي ابن غالب ابن فهم ابن مالك ابن النضر
ابن نعم ابن فهر. In this Fihr, he was known as Quraysh. نعم, he was the first to be known as Quraysh, and that's where the tribe of Quraysh takes its name from. From Fihr ibn Malik.
Ibn Kinanata, Ibn Khuzaymata, Ibn Mudrikata, Ibn Ilyas, Ibn Mudar, Ibn Nizar, Ibn Ma'ad, Ibn Adnan, Ila Huna Ijma'ul Ummah, Wama Ba'dahu Ila Adama, La Yasihu Fihi Shay'un Yu'taman. Waqad Kana Rasulullah Sallallahu Alayhi Wasallam Ila Intasaba. لم يجاوز في نسبته مع ابن عدنان ابن أدد ثم يمسك ويقول كذب النسابون. قال الله تعالى وقرونا بين ذلك كثيرا. وهذا النسب أشرف الأنساب على الإطلاق. فعن العباس رضي الله تعالى عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إن الله خلق الخلق فجعلني من خيرهم ثم تخير القبائل فجعلني من خير قبيلة ثم تخير البيوت فجعلني من خير بيوتهم فأنا خيرهم نفسا وخيرهم بيتا. وعن واثلة بن الأسقعي رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله اصطفى من ولد إبراهيم إسماعيل واصطفى من ولد إسماعيل بن كنانة
بني كنانة
واصطفى من بني كنانة قريش واصطفى من قريش بني هاشم واصطفاني من بني هاشم.
نعم. So this is the نسب الشريف of Nabi Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, and out of all of the lineages of all human beings, this is the most noble, the most elite, and the most pure that of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he mentions that when he sallallahu alaihi wasallam would mention his own nasab and his own lineage, he would stop at Ma'ad bin Adnan and he would not go any further. And then he would say that kadhaba an-nasabun. The people of genealogy would then tell untruths, for Allah Ta'ala says, and many generations in between. And so, from the son of Adnan, Ma'ad, all the way up into Ismail in Ibrahim, and then back to Sayyidina Adam, alayhim as-salam, then there are differing opinions. So there is nothing that is reliably transmitted regard to the ancestors beyond Adnan. No. And then he mentions how Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has chosen, or after creating all of mankind, he says, Allah placed me in the best amongst them, in the finest group. So this is istifa ilahi. This is divine selection and divine choosing. Then he chose the best of tribes and he placed me in the finest tribe. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is breaking down, categorizing the different creation of human beings. And then amongst all of those tribes, or amongst that tribe, he chose the best of the households and placed me in its finest. And so I am the best of them in soul and the best of them in households. Therefore, you cannot get any more pure, elevated lineage than that of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
No. وعن ابن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله اختار خلقه فاختار منهم بني آدم ثم اختار بني آدم فاختار منهم العرب ثم اختار العرب فاختار منهم قريشا ثم اختار قريشا فاختار منهم بني هاشم ثم اختار بني هاشم فاختارني فلم أزل خيارا من خيار ألا من أحب العرب فبحبي أحبهم ومن أبغض العرب فببغض أبغضهم.
Now, then he mentions here in this narration that Allah تبارك وتعالى إن الله اختار خلقه فاختار منهم بني آدم. Allah تعالى chose from amongst his creation the human beings. And then from amongst them he chose the Arabs. And from amongst the Arabs he chose Quraysh. From amongst Quraysh he chose Bani Hashim, meaning the descendants of Hashim, the grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or great-grandfather. And then from the sons of Hashim he chose me. And so I remain the best of the best, or the greatest of the ones that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala chose. And then he mentions, whoever loves the Arabs, the Arab, then I love them, for they love me. And whoever hates the Arabs, then I hate them, for they hate me. And this is all connected to the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he is from amongst the Arab, and he is from amongst Bani Hashim, and he is from amongst Quraysh. Now, next section is Asma, his noble names. Yaqra, who's next? Said Hadi.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اعلم أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أسماء كثيرة. قال الإمام النووي في تحذيب: قال الإمام الحافظ القاضي أبو بكر بن العربي المالكي في كتابه عارضة الأخوذي في شهر ترمذي، قال بعض صوفية: لله عز وجل ألف اسم، ولنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ألف اسم. وعن جبير بن مطعم بن عدي رضي الله تعالى عنه قال: قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: إن لي أسماء، أنا محمد وأنا أحمد وأنا الماهي الذي يمحو الله بي الكفر وأنا الحاشر الذي يحشر الناس على قدمي وأنا العاقب الذي ليس بعده نبي.
Now in this section inshallah he mentions the names of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam في أسمائه الشريفة. Not only are they أسماء, but they are أسماء شريفة. They're noble, they're honorable names, and every single name of Muhammadun Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam itself is ennobled because it's affiliated and attached to the most noble of creation, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so he has many names. Imam al-Nawawi, he mentions in Tahdhib, Tahdhib al-Asma wal-Lughat, it's said that the great Imam Ibn Abu Bakr Ibn al-Arabi mentions that some of the people of Tasawwuf have said that Allah has 1,000 names and that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has 1,000 names. In another hadith, he says, I have several names. I'm Muhammad, I'm Ahmad. And he's known as Muhammad on earth and he's Ahmad in the heavens. And when Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam gave the bishara and glad tidings and good news of Prophet coming after him, he mentioned him by the name of Ahmad. He says, I am al-mahi, al-mahi, meaning yamhu Allahu al-kufra bi. Allah Ta'ala erases, removes disbelief through him. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, he says, my similitude is like a person who comes to a fire and there are moths that are gathering around that fire attracted to its light. And he tries to push the moths away so they don't harm themselves, but they still want to come back to the fire because they're attracted to it. This is his job, alayhi salatu wassalam. He's wiping us away from dalal, from darkness, from kufr, from disbelief, from error, from displeasure of Allah. He says, I am al-hashir, the gatherer, at whose feet humankind shall gather. The greatest of groups on Yawm al-Qiyamah will be the group of Muhammad. The greatest of teams on Yawm al-Qiyamah will be the team of Muhammad. The greatest of umam, of nations, on Yawm al-Qiyamah will be the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the only ummah that can come anywhere near his in number is the ummah of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam. No one else. Because every Nabi will have a hawd, and Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw this. He saw this during his Isra and his Mi'raj. Every Nabi will have a hawd, have a basin which they'll come to drink from that particular Prophet. And there'll be Prophets who come and they'll be at the hawd and there'll be no one there. And they'll be ready to give people. No one believed in them. No one followed them. And there will be other prophets that come. There will be few people that came. And then Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam will have the next greatest number just before the hawd of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There will be only one flag, by the way, raised on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Only one flag. Nowadays, the United Nations has hundreds of flags and the world has hundreds of flags, and every decade or century or two they change the flags and they change the names of the countries. They think that they're all powerful. But after this entire existence is annihilated, there's only going to be one flag that's raised, and it's called Liwa'ul Hamd. If people haven't been introduced to its colors, then they should be introduced to them today. If they're not aware of who's going to hold that banner, his name is Muhammad, the son of Abdullah. And that's the knowledge that's going to benefit. People nowadays, they know how to salute, and they know how to stand for their national anthem. The international anthem on Yawm al-Qiyamah is the one which Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is going to go to the Hadra al-Rabbaniyya al-Ahadiyya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and will fall down in sujood. The best act of worship that he performed in dunya, he will reiterate and repeat on Yawm al-Qiyamah. That's consistency. That's thabat. That's istiqama. قُلْ آمَنْتُ بِاللَّهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَقِمْ. And then Allah Ta'ala will say to him, Irfa' ra'saka ya Muhammad, wasal tu'ta, washfa' tushaffa'. Raise your head, O Muhammad. Ask whatever you want. People nowadays, they're confused with genies and three wishes and this and that. No one can give any wish for anyone, because Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is the one that grants the khayr of this world and the next. And so, before he, alayhi salatu wasalam, asks Allah for the commencement of judgment, before he asks, he'll praise Allah with words that no other creature before him has ever used. Never. And he was the most eloquent of people. It wasn't even words that he, alayhi salatu wasalam, never used before. Allah Ta'ala will inspire upon his mubarak, blessed qalb, those words of thana, those words of praise and thanks and elevation of Allah Azza wa Jal. And then he'll ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to commence the hisab. And then the judgment begins. So he's the one that's going to raise that flag. He says, I'm al-Aqib, after whom there's no prophet. He says, La Nabiya Ba'di. One man in history came and he said, I'm a prophet. They say, how can you say you're a prophet? Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last of the prophets. He's a seal of prophets. No one after him. He says, I'm a prophet. The prophet Muhammad, he prophesied. He said that I'm going to come. What are you talking about? He said, yeah, my name is La. And Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, La Nabiya Ba'di. You don't understand. La here is not ism, but it's negation. It's a nafi. Different in Arabic. The same word, La. La Nabiya Ba'di, he means there shall be no prophet after me. Not the name of the prophet after me will be La. But this is the case. There are people that pop up in every zaman, dressed up in different costumes, making certain claims, sometimes amongst us, subhanallah, but Allah tabarak wa ta'ala makes them just like waves. They just come and they go. No. And did we read the next hadith? No.
وعن حذيفة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال لقيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في بعض طرق المدينة.
How much will we give to be in the shoes of حذيفة or in the نعل of حذيفة? He says لقيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. الله أكبر. He says I came across نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في بعض طرق المدينة. How much you would give just to be something on one of the طرق, on the alleyways, on the paths of Medina? A little bird or a little insect or a little atom of what you call oxygen or nitro or whatever else is in the atmosphere. Sayyidina Hudhayfa, istifa, this is istifa Rabbani. Allah Ta'ala chose the Sahaba and the alleyways of Medina and the mud brick houses of Medina and the birds of Medina and the hammam of Medina. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala chose, and the camels of Medina and the goats of Medina and the sheep of Medina. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala chose them all. And He chose the city itself. Al-Madina al-Munawwara. Before it was called Yathrib. كيف تنورت؟ تنورت بمجيء النور. It was illuminated and it became radiant through the arrival of the nur, of the great light, and that is the light of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Sayyidina Hudhayfa, mashallah, he says, I met the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on one of the streets of Medina. What did he say?
فقال أنا محمد وأنا أحمد.
اللهم صل وسلم عليه.
وعلى نبي واصطفى من ولد إسماعيل إسماعيل نبي كنانة.
وأنا نبي الرحمة.
واصطفى من.
وأنا أنا محمد أنا أحمد وأنا نبي الرحمة.
وأنا نبي الرحمة ونبي التوبة وأنا المقفي. وأنا الحاشر وأنا نبي الملاهم ومعنى المقفي المتبع من قبله من الرسل وكان آخرهم وخاتمهم والملاهم هي الخلود.
نعم عليه الصلاة والسلام. ففي تسميته continue. ففي تسميته
صلى الله عليه وسلم نبي الملاهم إشارة إلى ما بعث به من القتال بالسيف ولم يجاهد نبي وأمته قد ما جاهد صلى الله عليه وسلم وأمته والملاهم التي وقعت وتقع بين أمته وبين الكفار لم يعهد مثلها قبله فإن أمته يقاتلون الكفار في أقطار الأرض على تعاقب الأعصار إلى أن يقاتلوا أعور الدجال وفي تهذيب سماه الله عز وجل في القرآن رسولا نبيا أميا شاهدا مبشرا نذيرا داعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا ورؤوفا رحيما مذكرا وجعله رحمة ونعمة ونعمة وهاديا صلى الله عليه وسلم.
نعم. So in his travels in Medina, in his walking in Medina, Sayyidina Hudhayfa radiallahu ta'ala anhu has the honor of hearing directly the kalam and the speech from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he exposes the reality of himself and the descriptions of his of himself through his blessed and Mubarak names. And he says, I am Muhammad, Ana Muhammad. Ana Ahmad, I am Ahmad. Muhammad is the one that is praised often. And Ahmad is the one that praises like no one else praises. He is praised often, meaning there is no human being that is going to be praised like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There's no human being that's going to be elevated like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No mention of Allah except the mention of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No mu'addin calls the mu'mineen 5 times a day to prayer except with the name of Allah. They mention the name of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And no mu'min performs his 5 daily prayers except he mentions the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And not only that, he sends salam upon Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his prayer. But not only that, were he not to send salam by saying assalamu alayka ayyuha an-nabiyyu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, we say the fuqaha ya faqih, O jurist, is his salah sahih? Is it valid or is it invalid? He says it's invalid if he doesn't give salam, if he doesn't greet this man Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What if you greet someone else? What if you greet the person next to you? What if you greet your shaykh? What if you greet your father, your mother? Invalidates the salah. La ilaha illallah. But Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it rectifies the salah. It validates the salah. It makes the salah accepted before Allah azza wa jal. But no other human being is of that particular status. Naam. Wa ana Ahmad wa ana nabiyur rahma. Wa ma arsalnaka illa rahma lil alameen. This is the only reason Allah says that I have sent you. Wa ma arsalnaka, because here is a negation. And then after the negation, there is the exception, the ada' al-istithna illa. Therefore, that which comes after the ada' al-istithna, the particle of exception, is extreme in its emphasis. Rahmatan lil alameen. He is the rahman, he is the mercy for the alameen. He's the mercy for all, because he's the mercy for the animals, because the animals came and they complained to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he freed them and he advocated on their behalf before these organizations of animal rights in the RSPCA. Nowadays they claim that they come to save the animal rights, but our brothers and sisters in Gaza and in Palestine, what are they? What are they? 40,000, 45,000, 100,000, until what number does the massacre, genocide tally have to get to in order for them to come and to save these souls and these arwah? But Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the true rahmah. He was the true mercy. Wa Nabiyyu Tawbah, he is the prophet of Tawbah, the prophet of repentance. He says sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كُلُّ بَنِي آدَمْ خَطَّى. Every child of Adam is going to make mistakes, is a sinner. وَخَيْرُ الْخَطَّائِينَ. But the best of those who sin, التَّوَّابُونَ. They are the ones who often return to Allah. And the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum would count in the one majlis, in the one gathering, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَارْحَمْنِي وَتُوبْ عَلَيْهِ. Oh Allah, forgive me. Oh Allah, have mercy upon me. Oh Allah, accept my repentance. And He is the one who gave us the gift of Sayyidul Istighfar. Allahumma tarabbi la ilaha illa anta khalaqtani wa ana abduka wa ana ala ahdika wa wa'dika ma istata'at. من شر ما صنعت أبوء لك بنعمتك علي وأبوء بذنبي فاغفر لي فإنه لا يغفر الذنوب. ما شاء الله. سيد الاستغفار is the master of forgiveness. If you want Allah تبارك وتعالى to forgive you, come with سيد الاستغفار. And Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم is the master of those who sought forgiveness from Allah عز وجل. Even though Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala protected him, freed him from any error, from any deviation, from any sin, out of his rahmah for us, he taught us how to make istighfar. So after the greatest act of servitude we perform, and that is our salah, he teaches after you come and devote yourself 5 times a day in your salah, ask Allah for forgiveness. Teaching us what it means to be humble, to have tawadu'. You did this wonderful act of worship, but after it, ask Allah Ta'ala to plug those gaps, to fill those gaps, to pardon those mistakes, the moments of ghafla and heedlessness that I had in my salah, ask Allah Ta'ala to forgive. So he's Nabiyyu Tawbah. He says, wa ana al-muqaffi. And then he says there, and this is the method of Imam al-Nabahani, after certain terms that come in the various ahadith and the descriptions that may not be common in the understanding, he comes in the next line or next page and he'll say the meaning of this word is this, the meaning of that word. So he tells us, Al-Muqaffi, Al-Muttabi' man qablahu min al-Rusul, the one who follows those who preceded him amongst the messengers. وَكَانَ آخِرَهُمْ وَخَاتِمَهُمْ. He's the last. He's the seal. Therefore, he taught us this sunnah. And that is, he didn't come with anything new, but he came to renew. And so therefore, we have nothing new, but all we do is we renew the deen, and we transmit the deen, and we convey the deen. We don't get anything from our head, but rather we connect it back through our chains, back to the source and the origin, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَأَنَا الْمُقَفِّي. So al-muqaffi he means, I am the one that follows the way of the messengers that came before me. وَأَنَا الْحَاشِرْ. وَأَنَا الْحَاشِرْ وَنَبِيُّ الْمَلَاحِمْ. And he mentions here, al-malahim, the wars or the battles. And then he mentions, Nabi al-Malahim here refers to that which he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, has been sent of al-qital bis-sayf. The barahil of jihad were three for the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. From the point of not being permitted to retaliate to the persecution and the harm that they were being exposed to amongst Quraysh, until where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the permission to be on the offensive and on the defensive in order to ward off any potential risk or harm. And the first of the major battles that the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum fought in the company of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was that of the battle of Badr in the second year after Hijrah. And he then mentions that the battles that have occurred and that will continue to occur between the mu'mineen and the kuffar, between the believers and the disbelievers, لَمْ يُعْهَدْ مِثْلُهَا قَبْلَهُ فَإِنَّ أُمَّتَهُ يُقَاتِلُونَ الْكُفَّارِ فِي أَقْطَارِ الْأَرْضِ عَلَى تَعَاقِبِ الْأَعْصَارِ. He says this is going to be a continuous prevalent quality and manifestation from one generation to the next. And the jihad was not something that was specific for Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but rather previous prophets and messengers also led their people in jihad, but it becomes most prominent in the ummah of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all the way up until على تعاقب الأعصار إلى أن يقاتلوا الأعور الدجال, until it culminates and peaks in the great battle between Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam and his anti-Christ, the false Messiah, the false Messiah.
قال وعن ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اسمي في القرآن محمد وفي الإنجيل أحمد وفي التوراة وحيد وإنما سميت أحيد لأني أحيد أمتي عن نار جهنم.
نعم. So he صلى الله عليه وسلم takes away or moves away his ummah from the fire of Jahannam.
وزاد نقلا عن ابن عساكر الفاتح وطه وياسين وعبد الله وخاتم الأنبياء.
نعم. Additional names: الفاتح, the opener, the conqueror; طه, ياسين; عبد الله, خاتم الأنبياء, the seal of the prophets.
وقال القسطلاني في المواهب والباحوري في حاشية الشمائل ذكر صاحب
الباجوري
في حاشية الشمائل ذكر صاحب كتاب شوق العروس وأنس النفوس وهو حسين ابن محمد الدامغاني نقلا عن كعب الأحبار أنه قال اسم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عند أهل الجنة عبد الكريم.
So in this narration we have that the name of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم amongst the residents of Jannah is عبد الكريم, and of course the karam of Allah تبارك وتعالى manifests clearly in Jannah, where this dunya is based on asbab, it's based on means. If you're hungry, you go out and you work hard and you put in effort and you get an animal, you slaughter it and you skin it and you cook it and you prepare it. If you need bread, you go out and you plant the grains of the seeds of wheat and they grow, and then you harvest and then you grind and then you transport and then you bring it and then you mix it, put in effort. So anything that we need in this dunya generally is based on effort, but in akhirah, in Jannah, it's a removal of those means and then a manifestation of al-azama, al-qudra, al-ilahiyya, the great divine decree without any intermediary means whatsoever. And so a simple desire of the mu'min in Jannah, Allah Ta'ala will fulfill that desire. So Allah Ta'ala's karam and his generosity is clear and explicit in Jannah, unlike it being witnessed anywhere else or prior to that.
وعند أهل النار عبد الجبار وعند أهل العرش عبد الحميد.
نعم. عبد الجبار. الجبار is the compeller. No one can force Allah Ta'ala to do anything or not to do anything. If Allah Ta'ala commands, no one is going to prevent that command from being enforced. And those that end up in the hellfire, They're not going to be able to call upon anyone. Those that they called in this world for help and assistance and support, the tyrants and the oppressors, those who harmed and those who took the lives of others and their property without right, and they call on their acquaintances and their influences and their partners in crime in dunya, they can't call upon them in Jahannam, in hellfire. Allah Ta'ala is al-Jabbar, Allah is the compeller. No one can turn away his command. And so he says, Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is known as Abdul Jabbar amongst the residents of the hellfire. And amongst the bearers of the throne, the Arsh, Abdul Hamid. Because all the malaika are doing is Hamd of Allah and the Tasbih of Allah Azza wa Jalla. They're praising Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. And amongst the angels that Allah Ta'ala has created, there are those whom Allah Ta'ala created, and from the moment they created until the moment that Allah Ta'ala allows them to stop in their ibadah, they are either in standing, in qiyam, or either in ruku', in prostration, or bowing, or sitting. And when they rise, the first thing they say to Allah, Ya Rab, ma abadnaka haqqa ibadatik. They've been praising Allah Azza wa Jalla all that time. And they say, all that time, we have not been able to worship you in the way that you are deserving of being worshipped. No. Iqra.
وَعِنْدَ سَائِرِ الْمَلَائِكَ عَبْدُ الْمَجِيدِ وَعِنْدَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ عَبْدُ الْوَهَابِ.
عَبْدُ الْوَهَابِ. Al-Wahhab is the one who bestows gifts. What greater gift could there be than the gift of Nubuwa? And that's why they say, the greatest dua that anyone made for anyone, وَجْعَلِّي وَزِيرًا مِنْ أَهْلِ هَارُونَ أَخِي. Best dua any human being made for anyone. MashaAllah, he's converted from an ordinary human being to Nabi of Allah Azza wa Jal. Musa alayhi salam says, when Allah Ta'ala commissions him to go to Fir'aun with the Risala of Tawheed, and please, Ya Rab, give me an assistance, give me a support. How about it be someone from my family, my brother, Harun? Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam also, he didn't forget his ummah. He didn't forget his entire ummah. Because during his mi'raj, when he was in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Salamu alayna wa ala ibadillahi s-salihin. He says, peace be upon me, upon us, and all of Allah ta'ala's pious ibad. And amongst those are all of his believers and his followers in his ummah until the last day.
وعند الشياطين عبد القهار وعند الجن عبد الرحيم وعند الجبال عبد الخالق وفي البراري عبد القادر وفي البحار عبد المهيمن.
So Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam therefore is even known amongst the different parts of creation, whether it be the jinn or the shayateen or the lands or the mountains. Amongst the mountains, he's known also as Abdul Khaliq, the servant of the Creator. What greater creation can you see on earth than the jibal, than the mountains, and these great structures that Allah Ta'ala has made as pegs on the earth that bring its stability and soundness to the lands, Abdul Qadir, the one who is all-powerful, to the oceans as well, Bihar, Abdul Muhaymin.
وَعِنْدَ الْهِيْتَان Abdul Quddus وَعِنْدَ الْهَوَام Abdul Ghiyath وعند الوحوش عبد الرزاق وعند السباع عبد السلام وعند البهائم.
Even amongst the wild animals, subhanAllah, عبد الرزاق. The wild animals, they go and they seek their prey in order to obtain their rizq. Allah Ta'ala gives their rizq. And they know him as عبد الرزاق, the servant of the provider. And amongst the predatory animals, he is عبد السلام, the servant of the source of all peace, Allah. Now,
وعند البهائم عبد المؤمن.
البهائم. So those animals that generally live amongst people, or they domesticate them, the sheep or the goats or the cattle, عبد المؤمن, the servant of the faithful, or the one who grants security.
وعند الطيور عبد الغفار.
And the tuyur, so even the species of birds as well, Abdul Ghaffar.
وفي التوراة مؤذو 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 مؤذو. وفي الإنجيل طاب طاب.
نعم مؤذو 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 مؤذو. نعم.
وفي الصحف وفي الصحف حاكم. وفي الزبور فاروق. وعند الله طه وياسين. وعند المؤمنين محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم.
اللهم صل وسلم عليه. نعم.
وكنيته أبو القاسم لأنه يقسم الجنة بين أهلها.
نعم. And then finally he says with the believers he is known as Muhammad and he's also given the title of Abu al-Qasim, the distributor, because he distributes paradise between its inhabitants. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the reward of paradise and Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam distributes it amongst his inhabitants. And as we read before, each person according to their nasib of mahabbatahu lin Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will assume his rank in Jannah. And each person according to his takhalluq bi akhlaq Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How much are we in adopting his akhlaq and his mannerisms and his behavior and his character? That's going to determine how close you are to him on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And those who are closer to him on Yawm al-Qiyamah are those who are going to be assuming the highest of the levels and the darajat and the degrees of Jannah. Na'am. Imad Iqra.
قوله مؤذو مؤذو نقل في المواهب عن السهيلي أنه بضم الميم وإشمام الهمزة ضما بين الواو والألف ممدودا وقال نقلته نقلته عن رجل أسلم من علماء بني إسرائيل وقال معناه طيب طيب.
He says here the meaning here of مؤذو مؤذو. One of the names of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Tayyib, Tayyib, pure, pure. And the meaning of Taba, Taba, it also means pure, pure. The Gospel of Yuhanna, the Gospel of John. So, Al-Faruq means the one who distinguishes between the truth and the falsehood. And this is the name, same as the meaning of the name, Al-Baraqalit, Al-Madhkur, and that is mentioned in the Injil and the Gospel of Yuhanna, John, Gospel of John, Paraclete. وَقَدْ أَلَّفَ
وقد ألف خاتمه الحفاظ جلال الدين السيوطي رسالة سماها البهجة السنية في الأسماء النبوية جمع فيها نحو 500 ونقل في المواهب عن كتاب أحكام القرآن لأبي بكر ابن العربي أن لله تعالى 1000 اسم وللنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم 1000 اسم.
نعم. So 1000 names of Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned there in أحكام القرآن of Abu Bakr ibn al-Arabi, and previously in one of Imam al-Suyuti's texts he gathered نحو 500 names of Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم.
قال القسطلاني والمراد الأوصاف فكل الأسماء التي وردت أوصاف مدح وإذا كان كذلك فله صلى الله عليه وسلم من كل وصف.
And here the meaning Imam al-Qustalani says of all of these names of these asma, these are awsaf. These are referring to one particular aspect that describe him صلى الله عليه وسلم.
ثم إن منها ما هو مختص به أو الغالب عليه، ومنها ما هو مشترك، وكل ذلك بين للمشاهدة لا يخفى.
Some of his names or some of his descriptions are common between him and someone else, and others are specific for him, عليه الصلاة والسلام.
وإذا جعلنا له في كل وصف من أوصافه اسما بلغ أسماؤه ما ذكر بل أكثر.
Now, so it could even be more than the 500, more than the 1,000. If we look to all the descriptions of him صلى الله عليه وسلم, it will become even more.
قال والذي رأيته في كلام شيخنا يعني حافظ السخاوية في القول البديع والقاضي عياض في الشفاء وابن العربي في القبس والأحكام وابن سيد الناس وغيرهم يزيد على الأرض 400 ثم سردها مرتبة على حروف المعجم.
No. Next reader. Anyone else ready to read?
وذكر منها الإمام الجزولي في دلائل الخيرات 201.
نعم صاحب الدلائل دلائل الخيرات إمام دلائل الخيرات إمام الجزولي mentioned 201 201.
Anyone got black can read? Yeah, David, because someone for a parking.
Black Camry.
Who's got a black Camry?
No one.
There's a black car next door that's blocking.
Blocking someone's driveway.
Yeah. Is anyone here?
No. We're across the road. It's a Fortuna parking. No.
Maybe it's one of the neighbors.
وقال في التهذيب. وكنيته صلى الله عليه وسلم المشهور أبو القاسم، وكناه جبريل صلى الله عليه وسلم أبا إبراهيم.
نعم. It was said النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم had three sons. They died in infancy. One is Al Qasim, the other is Ibrahim, and the other is طيب. Abdullah. Ibrahim. Abdullah and Al Qasim. نعم. So they say that one of them was a double name.
Yeah.
نعم, double name. So three sons.
وأفضل أسمائه صلى الله عليه وسلم محمد. قال القسطلاني وقد سماه الله تعالى بهذا الاسم قبل الخلق بألف عام. وكما ورد في الحديث أنس رضي الله عنه. وروى ابن عساكر عن كعب الأحبر أن آدم أوصى ابنه شيئا فقال
أوصى
ابنه شيئا شيثا فقال
أي بني
أنت خليفتي من بعدي.
نعم. So here now he mentions رواية ابن عساكر from كعب الأحبار that آدم عليه السلام before his death he gave counsel. And as the Anbiya, before they die, they give counsel to those that are after them. And he takes Sheath. And Sheath is the one that took the legacy and the aman and the trust after Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam. He says, Ey Bunay, O my son, Anta Khalifati min Ba'di. So you're my successor. You're going to take the aman and the responsibility that I've carried after me.
فخذها بعمارة التقوى والعروة الوثقى وكلما ذكرت الله فاذكر إلى جنبه اسم محمد.
اللهم صل وسلم عليه. So from ما شاء الله from the son of Sayyidina Adam عليه السلام Sheath. He says to him, you know, be a person of taqwa. فخذها, take this aman and this trust. بعمارة التقوى, meaning ensure that you are a person who adopts taqwa in your life. والعروة الوثقى, that strong tight rope of faith in Allah, and every time, look, he even gives him tawsiyah and dhikr of Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala, wa kullama dhakarta Allah, every time you make dhikr of Allah, fadhkur ila jambihi isma Muhammad, each time you remember Allah, mention alongside your dhikr of Allah, the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, lima ya Adam? Why, oh Adam, why are you giving this counsel, this advice to your son Sheith?
فإني رأيت اسمه مكتوبا
اسمه
على
بالفتحة.
فإني رأيت اسمه مكتوبا على ساق العرش ثم طفت السماوات فلم أرى فيها موضعا إلا ورأيت اسم محمد مكتوبا عليه وإن ربي أسكنني الجنة.
So he says the reason why I'm telling you, O Sheith, whenever you make dhikr Allah, make dhikr Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says I saw that name, meaning the name Muhammad, written upon the arch of the Arsh of Allah, and after that I traveled through the heavens and I did not see a single place except the name Muhammad was written on it. Of course, there's nothing to compare, but when a human being loves another human being, when some guy loves a girl, I remember in school, people writing on desks, writes the names of someone. Some guy loves some girl, he writes the name wherever he goes, or the initials, wherever, in love. And these are human being to human being. And it's even not in a way that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he cannot contain himself except he has to express that love in writing. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala loves his Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much that Sayyidina Adam says that there is nowhere that I travel through the heavens except that I would see the name of Muhammad written there. So let it not be a surprise to us. Let us become accustomed to the ism of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and let us not prevent those whom Hidayah has not yet reached their hearts from realizing and appreciating the value of the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Therefore, the month of Rabi'ul Awwal, not only is it a month in which we strengthen our connection to Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but we also share that opportunity and that gift with those we don't know, who Allah Ta'ala has declared and decreed to be the su'ada. We don't know, they're kuffar now, but perhaps by us being the means to introduce them to ism Muhammad and awsaf Muhammad and khuluq Muhammad and sirat Muhammad and hayat Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, maybe we become the means that we grant them hidayah.
وَإِنَّ رَبِّي أَسْكَنَنِي الْجَنَّةِ فَلَمْ أَرَى فِيهَا قَصَرًا وَلَا غُرْفَةً إِلَّا وَجَدْتُ إِسْمَ مُحَمَّدٍ مَكْتُوبًا عَلَيْهِ.
There's no qasr, there's no palace in Jannah. Not only is there no palace, la ilaha illallah, there's no ghurfa in the palaces. There's no room in the palaces except the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is written. Who's giving us this observation? This is an eyewitness, Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam. You can't get a better eyewitness than him. Naam.
وَلَقَدْ رَأَيْتُ إِسْمَ مُحَمَّدٍ مَكْتُوبًا عَلَى نُحُورِ الْحُورِ الْعَيْنِ.
Naam, even upon the necks of the women of Jannah, the Hur.
وَعَلَى وَرَقِ قَصَبِ الْآجَامِ الْجَنَّةِ.
Naam, the leaves of the trees or the branches of the trees, even is written Muhammad.
وَعَلَى وَرَقِ شَجَرَةِ طُوبَى. وَعَلَى وَرَقِ سِدْرَةِ الْمُنْتَهَى. وَعَلَى أَطْرَافِ الْحُجَبِ.
Naam. So even these Mubarak trees in Jannah and the curtains of Jannah.
وَبَيْنَ أَعْيُنِ الْمَلَائِكَةِ فَأَكْثِرْ ذِكْرُهُ.
Even between the eyes of the angels is written the name Muhammad. So therefore be abundant in your remembrance of him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why?
فَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَةَ تَذْكُرُهُ في كل ساعاتها.
So some people think that all the malaika do is they make dhikr Allah. With dhikr Allah, they do dhikr of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because Allah reminds us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ. This is part of their dhikr Allah. Part of their dhikr Allah is their salah ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and their taslim, and their salutation upon him. Now,
قال حسان بن ثابت رضي الله تعالى عنه أغر عليه للنبوة خاتم من الله من نور يلوح ويشهد وضم الإله اسم النبي إلى اسمه إذا قال في الخمس المؤذن أشهد وشق له من اسمه ليجله فذو العرش محمود وهذا محمد.
الله أكبر. حسان بن ثابت ما شاء الله الصحابي رضي الله تعالى عنه. In these three lines he says a seal of prophethood from Allah has appeared, khatamun min Allah. But not only that, upon him there is a light that's radiant, that's witnessed, that can be seen. And that light of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would come into the dark room of Sayyida Aisha when her lantern had turned off and the entire room filled with light. And she says she was looking for her needle that she had dropped. And it was dark, there was no light. As soon as the face of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam popped in through the door, it became illuminated. And when the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, during the marad al-maut, during the sickness of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the end of his days, when he moved aside the curtain that was between him and the masjid, and the Sahaba in salah, they were about to leave their salah because of the intensity of the light that shone from the face of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وهكذا. And Allah attached the name of His Prophet to His name. How? When the Mu'adhin calls out every time, five times a day in the Adhan. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. He portioned out to him from His name to exalt Him. Allah Ta'ala is Dhul Arsh. He is the possessor of the throne. Mahmudun. He is Mahmud, meaning Allah is the one that is praised. Also, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one that is praised. But here, Allah is the one that is praised. فَذُو الْعَرْشِ مَحْمُودٌ وَهَذَا مُحَمَّدٌ. And this one here is Muhammad. So therefore, his name is taken from also from the name of Allah. Now, Imam al-Bajuri has a hashiya, meaning a brief commentary on the Shama'il al-Muhammadiyya of Imam al-Tirmidhi.
هو في الأصل أفعال تفضيل وسمي بذلك لأنه أحمد الحامدين أحمد الحامدين لربه.
Now he is the one who praises amongst all those who praise. He is the one that praises the most, praises the best, praises the most pure, praises the most sincere out of all those who praise. That's the meaning of Ahmad.
ففي الصحيح أنه يفتح عليه يوم القيام يوم القيامة بمحامد.
الصحيح هي meaning the صحيح of Imam al-Bukhari. It's narrated that he صلى الله عليه وسلم يفتح عليه, meaning he'll receive openings upon him. Allah Ta'ala will inspire him.
أنه يفتح عليه يوم القيامة بمحامد لم يفتح بها على أحد قبله.
نعم. So no one else before him, as we mentioned before, will receive those inspirations, those openings of words of praise. And of course, اللسان ترجمان القلب. All the tongue does is it interprets, it exposes that which lies hidden in the qalb. So all his qalb sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his hamd, in his praise of Allah, now manifests in words that are heard on his tongue. He will have that flag or that standard of hamd of praise on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Allah, and you can see that all of these gifts are connected to what? To hamd, to praise. He has the banner of praise, liwa'ul hamd, and he has the station of praise, or the praiseworthy station, al-maqam al-mahmud, meaning it's a praiseworthy station. There will be no one who sees that station and that status, except he will praise it, and he will praise the one that occupies it. And he will realize that it is above and beyond everyone else's station. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, says on the day of rising, the ones who will have the longest necks are the ones who used to call to the salah. And the salah itself is the greatest act of worship of Allah. So the one who calls to the salah has the highest of necks. And what about the one who taught us the salah? He will be the most prominent on Yawm al-Qiyamah, alayhi salatu wa salam.
وبالجملة فهو أكثر الناس حامدية ومحمودية فلذلك سمي أحمد ومحمد.
Now, so he therefore has the most praising nature and the most praiseworthy nature. The most praising nature meaning there is no one amongst people that by default praises like he praises his Lord, and he has the most praiseworthy nature of all people. Meaning if you're going to look at anything that's worthy of being praised, you're not going to find anything or anyone like him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
ولهذين الاسمين الشريفين مزية على سائر الأسماء.
These two names, what are these two names? Why they have a distinctive quality over all other names? The names which ones? Ahmad and Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم.
فينبغي تحري التسمية بهما فقد ورد في الحديث القدسي إني أليت على نفسي أن لا أدخل النار من اسمه أحمد ولا محمد. رواه الديلمي عن علي رضي الله تعالى عنه ما من مائدة وضعت فحضر عليها من اسمه محمد أو أحمد إلا وقدس الله ذلك المنزل في كل يوم مرتين.
Allah. These qualities of the names of Ahmad and Muhammad, he says, so it is a must that extra care is taken with naming others with them. In the Hadith Qudsi, Allah says, I've taken it upon myself that no one named Ahmad or Muhammad should enter the hellfire. Yeah. Allah, Allah, Allah. Inni alaytu ala nafsi alla udkhila an-nara man ismuhu Ahmad wa la Muhammad. That's why you find some muhibbin, mashallah, any name that they want to give their child, Muhammad is going to be one of the names. There was going to be maybe a middle name or a first name or a second name or something. Muhammad this, Muhammad that. Always. To ensure that that child takes the barakah of the name Muhammad and is protected and prevented from entering the hellfire. And also another narration from Sayyidina Ali, that there is no ma'ida, there's no table spread, which the food is laid out on. And there comes upon it, or attends it, someone who is named either Ahmad or Muhammad, إِلَّا قَدَّسَ اللَّهُ ذَلِكَ الْمَنْزِلِ, except for that particular home, that particular house, Allah Ta'ala will honor it, purify it. فِي كُلِّ يَوْمٍ مَرَّتَيْنِ, twice, every single day. Just because a person by the name of Muhammad or Ahmad, mashallah, came and attended that ma'ida. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to grant us qurb to Sayyidina Ahmad and to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to Sayyidina Al-Hashir and Sayyid Al-Tawbah and Sayyid Al-Mutawadi'een and Sayyidina Taha and Sayyidina Yasin alayhi salatu wa salam in this month of Rabi' al-Awwal. We'll stop there, inshallah. Continue tomorrow from al-bab al-thani fi sifati khilqati rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his outward physical descriptions. Al-Fatiha Allah tabarak wa ta'ala yanzur ilayna yatub alayna yaftah alayna futuh al-arifin ويجمعنا بالنبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ظاهرا وباطنا يقظة ومناما ويجعلنا من المكثرين من ذكر الله ومن ذكر رسوله ومن الصلاة والسلام عليه وعلى أصحابه وعلى آله وعلى أزواجه وعلى تابعيه بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. وأن الله تبارك وتعالى يربطنا وأهالينا وأحبابنا وجيراننا وكل من له حق علينا بالمصطفى محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم ربطا لا ينحل أبدا ويخلقنا بأخلاقه ويمدنا بمدده. وأن الله تبارك وتعالى يجعلنا ممن يتبع سنته ويحيي أوصافه وأخلاقه في حياتنا وفي ليالينا وفي نهارنا وفي حركاتنا وفي سكناتنا وفي قبالنا وفي إدبارنا وفي نياتنا وفي كل ما يخطر على بالنا. وأن الله تبارك وتعالى يحسن النيات ويرفع درجات ويتقبل الأعمال ويجمعنا على حوضه صلى الله عليه وسلم ويريدنا عليه ويسقينا من يده الشريف شربة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا على هذه النية وعلى ما نوى سيد الحبيب عمر في هذه المجالس وفي هذه الزيارات وفي هذه القراءات. أن الله تبارك وتعالى يغفر لنا ما مضى ويحفظنا فيما بقي من أيامنا ولا يدينا ويبارك في أعمارنا ويشفي مرضانا ويقضي حوائجنا الدينية والدنيوية والبرزخية والأخروية في خير ولطف وعافية.
سيدي الفاتحة.
اللهم صل وسلم على محمد.